across all their levels, you know, the nature of our business. And then...
It's all about the sound guy.
Let's talk about the first match. Yeah, the sound guy has his work cut out for him today. And plus, we're on handhelds, and I'm really loud, and you're not. So, first match, speaking of UK teams, FM Esports versus Mousesports.
Yep.
Why don't you walk us through? I know you know the FM guys really well.
I know them very well. Like I said, FM as an organization was the organization that gave me my first break in esports, doing community casting with them and writing up news and then eventually managing the team. I pretty much did it all with them first. You know, so I know them a long, long time. I know these particular cluster of players. I got to be honest and say this is one of the weaker teams that they've fielded at an international event. There's no getting away from that. Their standout players are probably Zed and Jacob. They're the most experienced. They're going to be the big guys, the go-to guys. Jacob has a history of putting together UK teams, and he's a very good leader. Not so much of a fragger, you know, but he's a very good leader, a very good captain. On paper, though, they got some really inexperienced players here that are going to find this a difficult step up, I think. You know, guys like Spuds and Reason and Shiki, you couldn't call these UK elite players. There's no getting away from that. And this is either going to be make or break in terms of the career because they're going to be playing against the side that probably aren't great shakes either. This is like the bargain basement. This is the battle of are we going to go into the group stages? So I think there's a lot of pressure on the UK players. There's been a lot of... you know, kind of speculation about is UKCS dead? These guys, they'll have heard that, they'll have seen that. They're going to want to come out all guns blazing, make a name for themselves. But equally, with that comes the pressure. If you underperform, people are going to start talking.
Yep. And then let's hopefully we can pull up rosters, and we'll start with FM Esports, and let's actually go through the rosters. Yep. And again, I'm waiting for my monitor to give us that stuff. We're still looking at in-game. Hopefully you guys are not looking at in-game.
I don't know, maybe they are.
And again, FM Esports, Mousesports. We have the, while we're waiting for our graphics to come up, we do have the maps.
We've had the veto.
Yeah, and the way the system worked, if you guys aren't familiar, obviously there's five maps in the pool, the standards, with the addition of Cash. So we've got Cash, Nuke, Dust2, Mirage, Inferno are our maps for the entire tournament. And the way they do the picking is they do a coin flip, and the loser of the coin flip gets the first veto. And the way this one worked is Mousesports got that first pick. They eliminated Cash. Mm-hmm. Then FM Esports eliminated Nuke. Mm-hmm. And then Mousesports eliminated Inferno, leaving two maps. And then that other team then basically picks the map they're playing.
Yeah.
And they picked Mirage. So FM had the choice between Dust2 and Mirage.
Yep.
They took Mirage.
And I'm hugely surprised by that decision. I think FM Esports have made their first mistake in picking Mirage because that is this isn't a team. I mean, FM Esports, they're a mix right now. I mean, effectively, several of the players have been murking with other teams. Jacob was playing with PC Hire just recently at other UK events. This isn't the same lineup. So this is like, they're all going to be feeling each other out. Mirage is an unforgiving map for that. This is a map where you've got to do rotations, you've got to be on point, communication's key, you've got to control mid. You can be hit from multiple angles as CT. You need to hit from multiple angles as T. That requires coordination, communication.
Mirage is, when you play it on the CT side, it's actually all about having a lot of experience, like knowing where the information is coming from and what does that mean, where do I rotate to. So if you play Dust2, that's one of the most simple, like, plug and play maps. Everyone knows the rough timings of when you rotate and stuff. So it means that if you're the lesser team, then you just go for, like, we can just hit our shots. Whereas on Mirage, you can hit your shots, you can get your kills, but if you don't have the rotation and the chemistry, then it won't even matter. You won't be able to get the retake on the other side. So I would assume they must have something planned here since they got the pick. That's the key thing. It's not the other team picked it at the end. They actually got to choose not to take Dust2. So that makes me have to figure they must have something in mind, but I don't see the gamble working, put it that way.
Gotcha.
Yeah,
and again, production's got our monitor working.
Yay,
hey,
now we can see what you see.
Hopefully you've been seeing us the whole time. So let's actually have you, Thorne, go through the rosters. So hopefully we're going to see some roster plates. We're going to start with FM Esports, and let's walk through each player, you know, as we see them on the screen. I'm going to keep filling up here until we actually, we look pretty good now that I can see us.
I was going to say, man, I should get an earring.
And again,
midlife crisis.
Okay. And player cards are still being kind of adjusted, so we're going to skip that for the first map. Again, we've got some, you know, first-time organization hitting our side of the world, so we do ask that you give, you know, Gfinity a little bit of leeway than more maybe you would give one of our normal Counter-Strike people. We like them. They're really good guys, but again, they got a big endeavor going and first time in our world, so it's a little different than what they're used to doing. So again, we've got some bugs in the work, as always. So why don't we just talk about the rosters? You know these guys, especially Mousesports, really well. Why don't you start with FM, and let's go by player by player and just give a little info.
I'll let you jump in.
You know me. I'm actually anti-hype by philosophy, okay? I actually think it's like immoral to hype things unfairly. So, but that's because I think Counter-Strike's a good enough game where you don't have to oversell it. Okay, there's really good players in the game. So as a result, I set that up to say I know nearly none of these players from FN Esports. They're not a good team. They haven't got a lot of experience. So as a result, you should know in the context of this game, if they start to do well and they start to win, that's a huge result for these guys. This is like playing as much better players. So like Richard said, yeah, okay, JKM is the most famous player from this team. We know him from the UK scene. But some of these players, if you go down to like Sheiky, no one knows who that is. Like, some of his team might not know who that was like 2 months ago. This is the sort of person we're getting, you know, here. Sure. This is like someone trying it out at his first big LAN. So that's a context to understand. I mean, is there anyone here who actually potentially would be like one of the UK best players?
I would say, like, if we're talking about potential, there's two people I really want to highlight here. And that is, I mean, I agree with Sheiky. He's a bit of a hero in terms of the UK scene. He's played in some okay UK teams. He was touted as maybe being, you know, a player that could step it up. I don't know why it didn't happen for him. Maybe it's a mentality thing. George Zed Bear, the beautifully named George Zed Bear. This is a guy who has been around top teams. He's been around those players. He knows Jacob very well. He came in as a merc in a UK Cup that I casted recently, and he looked sharp. He looked good. It was a step up for the team that brought him in, the guy he was replacing. So Zed is probably the guy to watch. Reason, he's the other guy that I want to point out because he is a younger player. Not a lot of people know him, but people respect what he does in these late night UK mixes, which is pretty much all we've got left in our scene. And he is a very competent player. So I think if those guys can hit their shots, they might catch Mousesports cold. But I definitely agree with Duncan in the sense that this is FM Esports final. They've got to win this. They're under huge pressure. If they don't, they're not going to be in the knockout stages tomorrow because they will not beat anyone else.
It's only going to get harder after this match for them.
Yeah,
for
of course it is. Sure. I mean, look how stacked that group is. They've got to beat Mousesports. I think they can do it, but I think this is a game that's going to be super close. It's going to hinge on maybe one or two rounds, and that's going to require your players to make clutches. It's going to be about mistakes, not about quality.
Okay. And why don't you hit us up with some Mousesports info?
Mousesports roster?
Yeah.
Okay, well, the key thing in the context of FM Esports is that it's not as though, okay, Mousesports have more well-known players, much more tenured players in the European scene, but actually, historically, they're the team who do well online, and then when they go to the big LAN, they're usually in the position FM Esports now is everyone's saying, oh, they're the one team that won't win the game, and they're going out first. So actually, if you're going to play a team in your first game at a big LAN, you want to play someone else who also doesn't have that pedigree and the veteran status where, oh, we're definitely going to cruise through this game. So, okay, if we go here on the lineup, the three players that immediately jump out is Nuki, Legica, I don't know how you say that, and Chris J. They've always been the core of this team. And actually, they've always been floating around that scene. And they've always had these multinational European teams. It's never been just one country in their lineups. The key addition to this lineup that everyone wants to see in this game is Alu. Because when he came in the Finnish scene, it was back in 2011 was when he started to make his rise. And 2012 was when he really like jumped into the best Finnish team. He was like the prospect. He was the person everyone thought if 1.6 had continued, he'd be the next like potentially really good player, okay? And his problem in CSGO really hasn't been his play. He's been playing very well. It's that the Finnish scene's never really got it together. They've never managed to keep one lineup together and give him a platform to show his skills off. And so actually before he joined Mouse, everyone was saying, okay, I hope he can actually leave the Finnish scene, believe it or not. I want to see him play in a top team. Like, outside of the context of a Finnish team, would he be good? And this was obviously the team to go to because, as I mentioned, they're willing to go with these multinational rosters. He doesn't have to find another Finnish team. And so I'm actually looking to see how he will do because in terms of numbers and online performance, he's potentially been up there where if he plays some of these teams like a Titan or a Dignitas, he could go toe-to-toe with a couple of those AIM people that normally we expect to see in the frag movies.
All right, well, thank you very much, gentlemen. That wraps up our first little segment.
Awesome.
And folks, we've got two great casters. I'm going to throw it to our man Anders and Henry G, also ex-pro himself. So he's going to be doing color commentary. Anders and Henry G, take it away.
Thank you very much, Scott. Really appreciate it. Welcome to Gfinity once again, guys, and thanks for tuning in so early in the morning here. And obviously a big shout out to everyone in the audience as well who's already here. Got quite a few people watching. definitely great. Henry, this is exciting. I mean, this venue is very cool.
Yeah, well, this is the first time I've been in an arena for an esports event, and it's been amazing to be casting here. Like, it seems like the crowd is finally starting to turn up. We've got one of the stalls almost full, so yeah, it looks like it's going to be a good day, and it's nice we're actually going to be casting a home team to kind of kick things off, kind of bring some hype to the audience, perhaps.
That's nice, and actually, that's a good point to really start off with here, because part of what Gfinity is really helping to do is actually to try and bring some life back into the PC part of the of the UK scene, which is maybe a little bit more console-centered. So that's not necessarily bad, but it's great. I really appreciate that, because, I mean, historically speaking, you were telling me this earlier, there has actually been some good English Counter-Strike teams out there.
There has been, like, over the years, I think Counter-Strike has been a great game for the UK, but it's in the last year or so we've kind of really dwindled out of the scene as a whole. I don't think we have any teams kind of even residing in the top 20 right now.
Yeah.
So I think we have the players and we have the player base there to kind of build something together, but no one's kind of made that team yet, has made a kind of any sort of footprint in the scene whatsoever. But I think that's what it changed. I think events like this, where we actually have two UK teams having the opportunity to go toe-to-toe with these European teams, it could see a resurgence, and hopefully we'll see some of these UK teams actually challenge and hopefully kind of take some maps off the team. So that brings me on to the next point. So we've got FM Esports versus Mousesports. This is kind of a... this is their dream first game, I think, especially for FM Esports. If they were going to beat anyone in this group, I think this is the game they would go for.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, they're definitely Mousesports is you know, the easier team compared to the rest.
Yes.
Still don't think it's going to be an easy game for
they're
FM.
Definitely
but
not, but if they had to choose one, I'm saying it's like they could. This is the one that kind of, like, on paper, it looks like a new lineup, kind of could be some communication issues with all the multinational stuff, so...
Yeah, plus, I mean, you know, we're talking about a best-of-one game, and even though it's going to be on Mirage, which I actually agree with the panel about, it's going to be pretty a tough match to try and play Mousesports against.
Yeah.
I think it still is preferable in some ways to playing on Dust 2, because on Dust 2 you'd be facing Christie and Allo both with an AWP, and that would be a very, very tough matchup, I think.
Well, that's a good point. When we look at the FM Esports lineup, we can't actually see someone standing out as, like, a prominent AWPer, really, can we? Like, we see Allo and Chris J, some of the most feared names with the AWP. So I think that's going to be such a pivotal factor in this game, especially on a map like Mirage. We're going to see CTs kind of moving the AWPs around, kind of dominating that mid area, kind of facing from connector, the window, short, kind of surprise. I think that's going to be really difficult for FM Esports to control. So it's going to be interesting to see how they react to it. I know they've done their homework on this map. This is the map they wanted to play. So
oh, really?
I think in a best of one, first game of the day, this is kind of like everything's laid out for them to kind of show us what they can do. So let's see what they can bring to the party, to be honest.
Well, I mean, I think it's always pretty exciting when someone actually does the research, does the homework, and is ready to play a new team. But the problem is, and I think, you know, we discussed this a little bit earlier as well, the problem is if you do too much homework, if you get too focused on anti-strategy, as it were, and you forget some of the basics, that can also be a problem.
Absolutely. So, like, back in the day when I was playing, this is a long time ago, you have to forgive me this, but you kind of know, especially when the kind of lineup of games is announced so early on, like a week before, you kind of know who could be playing. And a lot of these teams, I think especially the UK teams, will dwell on, because they get an opportunity to watch all these teams online all the time, they'll dwell on the tactics and kind of what they're doing, they'll try to counter that. But they have to remember, these guys, they're not silly. They've got, like, Nookie in charge of their team. He knows what he's doing. Like, he's not going to go in with the exact same tactics. He's going to kind of bait out some of the reactions they're predicting. So, like, I think we'll expect to see, like, a lot of setup for the kind of traditional stuff that Mousesports will be doing online. But they're going to change it last minute, or perhaps they'll take the bomb to the other side by surprise.
Yeah.
So that's why I said to them, I know the UK guys obviously so well. I've been telling them, kind of, don't dwell on the anti-strategy. Play your own game.
Yeah.
Take something from it. Use it as a kind of help aid for you that you've known, you've seen how they play, and kind of maybe just focus on the way they play their CT positions and kind of hold their angles.
Well, I think some of the best Counter-Strike we've seen recently from some of the less known teams, like, you know, London Conspiracy, another one, they've won some of their games by playing just really basic Counter-Strike, really simple stuff. And people forget how to use that sometimes. Actually, they're not the only team. I think when Titan has been struggling, not so much now, because in the past couple of weeks they've been playing really well, but when they had their whole slump period, I think that's part of the reason was that they were too focused on the strategies.
Well, that's what they've always been about. Ever since I used to play against them in the Source, that was their main thing. They were so drilled and so methodical with their strategies. Like, a lot of teams like NIP are kind of more hybrid. They can kind of, like, they rely on, they have, like, some basic kind of set stuff, but at the end of the day, when they're playing on LAN and stuff, they're relying on their aim and their chemistry as a team to kind of bring it together. So a lot of teams can get caught up so much in these set tactics, and then as soon as they don't start working for them, say they lose a pick early on or they get surprised, that tactic just goes out the window and they're kind of caught in the headlights. They don't know how to react. So.
Yeah, well, we're going to go into the game now. So welcome once again, ladies and gentlemen. Hope you guys are going to tell your friends what's going on here on the stream. Remember to invite everyone. We want a really big audience. It's the first time that Gfinity are picking up Counter-Strike like this, and it's definitely very, very cool. We need all the organizational support we can for this game, and we are just ready here on Mirage. So we already kind of went through the lineup, but in case anyone's been joining us since, maybe we should just go through them. So for Mousesports, maybe the more known team here, we obviously have Tabson, Legia, Alu, Chris J and Nuki, but for the English roster.
FM Esports, we have George, Zed Bear, JKM, Reason, Spuds, Cheeky. So perhaps not some of the most famous UK names, but definitely up there in the UK scene. I think they definitely have the potential here to kind of, depending on whether they get the momentum at the start of the round, I think they could cause an upset. Players to watch, as Richard and Scoots mentioned, Zed and JKM. Reason perhaps as well, he's always been on the cusp of greatness in the UK, so I think he's looking for his breakout tournament. I think this could be the one. If he can find his kind of stride, he can perhaps kind of cause a bit of an upset. So player for me, MVP from FME was just going to be Zed, but I think as Thorin mentioned, everyone's kind of waiting to see how Ali performs on this event for Mousesports. I think he's definitely going to be the one to watch. He's just such a high fragger, can be a very versatile player, can AWP, can rifle, and he's kind of renowned as one of the best Finnish players. So I think this lineup, although it's kind of unorthodox the way they've approached it, they've definitely got the players on paper to kind of cause some absolute destruction.
I'm looking forward to it, and I think actually the one thing FM really has on their side is we're going to be going to the ninth round first of all, guys, decide who's going to be starting on what side, of course. But I think the one thing FM have going for them right here is the fact that there's almost no one expecting anything from them.
Yeah,
they have no pressure at all. Yeah. And actually, sometimes teams that play like that can be really dangerous to play against.
Yep, I agree. Like, if you kind of, if you go into a game like Mousesports, you can think, oh, this should be an easy game, kind of easy win. And as soon as things start going wrong for Mousesports, for example, they could, like, it could get really stressful for them. It could cause arguments with the team. Like, people say, well, why aren't you killing them? They're the slowest skill players. But I think as a team like that, you just need to focus on your own game. Don't get caught up on who you're playing against. I always try to focus on the team itself and kind of not well too much when you're playing. But here comes the ninth round. So for me, I think Mousesports take that. I think they'll probably want to stay terrorist because they know they're playing against a bit of a shaky lineup here. So, or swapping, so there.
I agree, though. I was definitely going to say, yeah, they win the ninth round. They start on the T side. That's the most common thing. But I guess a little bit like us too, where we've seen a lot of teams recently go for the CT side first.
Yeah,
maybe
absolutely.
It's the same logic here. Mousesports maybe trying to give themselves a little bit of room to work with in case they lose that pistol round. They're not going to be that far behind because it's the CT side and they can always get back into it a little bit maybe.
Yeah, well, I know these FM Esports players a lot and I know they've done their homework as I mentioned before. So I think this isn't too bad. And I think starting T, they've definitely got their set strats. And Mirage is all about kind of feeling out the map and then working out where to execute. So you kind of you send your players in a 2-1-2 lineup, kind of traditionally kind of underpass and using it. But as I bang on, here we go. We're starting the game, and let's jump into it.
Yeah, see what's going to be going on. And from the looks of it, just the 3 smokes that have been bought already, definitely a sign that
set tactics coming in straight away.
And you already said it. You're absolutely right. So here we go. And the way that Mousesports are set up, this is perfect for FM. If they can actually go for it right here, they're going to hit a timing that's almost godlike. This is going to be interesting. This looks family right here. Great job from our observer. Really well played there. You see the smokes on Alu. Well, he can shoot through. Oh, my God. He hits a headshot on Cheeky. That's not supposed to happen. That was definitely very, very lucky. The bomb does go down here, but Alu's actually going to make a second kill once again. Now it's Spuds, Jacob, and Reason left here, and Reason's going to go down. Legia with a headshot, that bomb taking away, but there's still a lot of time here for Mousesports to get it done, and they are both tramped down towards the slope. This is not looking good. Alu is looking for his third headshot, and as they peek, he's going to get one more. That's the triple, and there's going to be Nuki stealing the last one, but Alu, I mean, come on.
Opening frag of the tournament, and it's through a smoke, and it ruins the whole round for FM Esports. It'll be very frustrating. Obviously, like I said, I think we're going to see a lot of those set tactics from them. I think they've kind of been thinking, I think, obviously, like I said, I think they've been anti-stratting them. I think they knew Mousesports run that setup, no one on A. And although it was the right strategy to run, the Alu kind of almost lucked out there, but he kind of picked up a couple of frags as well. So
I don't normally like to call things luck in this game, but I actually think that time is really warranted because the timing that FM had hit there was actually really, really rare.
I think that's, we're going to see a lot of that from them. Obviously, they've done their homework against this team. They know how they set up, and you kind of saw that was perfect strategy, but unfortunately for them, they haven't opted for a head out, they've gone for a full block. Okay, so I think they'll just be able to bomb down. You can see a bomb down, a smoke down inside, ready for the bomb, but no luck there whatsoever.
No, but I like the fact that they tried anyway. It's such a tiny investment to putting that smoke in. They can still buy in this round anyway, so if they had got the bomb down, they would have probably, they could have picked up an AWP if they wanted to, but the fact that they can buy in the third round at least means that neither Chris or Alu will have picked up an AWP yet. So things are looking, you know, if they can steal this round away, they're still looking good.
Yeah, absolutely. So they wanted to kind of get the momentum in their favor now. Obviously, they've gone for a full, they've got AKs and Galils. Looks like more set strategy here. That looked like they're going towards a short area. Possibly kind of an execute onto A here for the connector, or going up short.
Yeah, it's really dangerous walking down the middle, but Mousesports, sorry, FM, they're using the smokes really well. That's a great opening. Tamsin goes down, it's nice AK work coming up from Sen, and now they have a lot more room to work with, especially as they got one guy up into the, towards the window room here, the ladder room. Not looking bad at all right now. They're going to be going up through the connector, and Alu's right here at the edge of the smoke. You can actually see them. They take down Chris in the site now. If they can just kill Alu, they're going to be fine. Over by short, actually, they might be able to catch someone else. I think, no, their gear picks up the kill on Jake, and that's a huge kill.
That's the flank coming in, and now FM-esports going to have a bit of a challenge here. Big, big round. They want to make sure no mistakes are made here. No one overfacing.
Leggy is looking for an opening, but oh, he's going to get spuds. Maybe a little bit too aggressive there. But now it's still back into a 2-on-2. The positions they have right now on FM are really good. And there is actually a smoke grenade up here on Mouse, so that could seal it. They're going to try for it. Shiki take one down. Alu now has no time left. He's going to have to go straight for the defuse. And Reason, he's not going to allow it. He's just waiting here. He gets the kill as well. And FM take the third round. Very nicely done by the British team.
Absolutely. Good opening frag there. They kind of the round should have gone their favor. Zed opening the frag on that connector. That's what opened the round up for them. I think we saw Alu there. He had such a... He had that smoke and that good positioning. If he had just had a bit more faith in himself to run through and kind of go for it, I think he could have turned around in their favor. But yeah, good opening gun round. We can actually see the CT still have enough money here to take another round. I'm not sure the terrorists will be expecting this. It's kind of almost a force buy from the CTs. Like not a full Arsenal grade. No head armor to speak of, really.
No, definitely a bit tricky because they're playing up against four Galils, so actually the head armor could be really useful.
Exactly, yeah, that's interesting to know, actually. So I think they're kind of opting that the T's would have had AKs, it wouldn't have mattered, but here we go, it'd be a deciding factor.
But I guess the fact that the reason that Mousesports can even buy now is because of the second round that FM played where they just all died. They didn't get a single kill in that second round. If they got two or three kills in that round, it would have been very different, but that's how it went.
This is a big investment. If we were a best of one tournament, I think I'd be telling my team we want to kind of make sure we guarantee ourselves and get our economy on track, even if you have to sacrifice a couple of rounds. This, to me, is a very risky tactic, and I'm not sure it's going to prevail for them, but let's see how it pans out. Quite a slow round here coming from fm-esports.
Now we'll find out. Legia waiting right here and looking for an opening, but the smoke's going to go off. Actually, that's really cool because that's one guy who's actually a lot of people occupied. He does go down. If Jacob stayed alive, he would have kept two or three people looking towards the middle now. The rest of the push coming in is going to be maybe a little bit more obvious here. I think Mousesports have a good setup for it, but a great opening. Spud's going to take down Tamsin. Nuki caught out, going to go down. Reason with the kill. And now Legia moving up towards the connector here. Gets an instant headshot on the bomb carrier, and that's obviously a big kill. He's looking for a second one. Is Alu going to be picking up a kill in the background? And it's back into a 2-on-2.
Here we go again. Alu with Chris J, the star players of Mousesports going into against Zed and Shiki. This is a huge round, as you mentioned, the economy of the CTs.
Yeah, bomb is down, so that's the first victory for FM, but they need a little bit more here. Alu's going to take a kill now. Zed, he's caught in a really weird corner. He's in the smoke, just hiding, and they're actually guessing he might be, and Chris will take him down. That's a triple from Alu, and the round is won by Mousesports. A really expensive round from the CT side, though.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, so that was huge stuff on them. Like, quite a big move to kind of force this buy. And obviously, we mentioned they had no head armor. Maybe the terrorists should have perhaps done a little bit better there. I think Shiki may have been overfacing and standing in the open there. But here we go. We can see Alu picking up the AWP now. And this is going to be all sorts of trouble for FM Esports. They're going to be forced onto a CZ buy here. And on a map like Mirage, I'm not sure what real possibilities there are with that. The angles don't really work in his favor, but you never know that gun, to be honest, if anything could happen.
Exactly. Six at 75, you can never really rule them out. I guess Mousesports are trying to just keep their distance. They really don't want to get taken down. Tamsin spots a couple of people down towards the slope, and actually he's gonna take a little bit of damage here. Quickly going down, Tamsin will fall. Now Nuki looking to clean up the last member for the triple here. Spuds close range, not gonna make it happen. Nuki will take him down. That's it. It's going to be 4-1 moving straight into the sixth round.
like we mentioned before, this is the best of one. There's no chance to warm up here. You kind of have to be ready to go as soon as you get on server. We've got Alu picking up the orb now. We won't see an orb coming from the terrorist, so they're going to have to make sure they utilize their spokes correctly and kind of avoid and lock him out of the game. So the best thing the CTs can do here is kind of just change his position and make him dynamic and kind of make sure he's not getting locked down by these set strategies.
And look at this cheeky play from Alu. Okay,
this is what I'm talking about, dynamic play, kind of keeping him up there.
This is really fun, isn't it? And actually, the way they're rushing up the middle right now, FM, maybe they have a chance of doing something. If they catch Mousesports down on the slope, it could be interesting. Tabson's going to go down. That's a great opening pick. And Reason picking up a double. Nuki falls. Alu alone inside the bombsite. Leggy is going to go down. This is looking so good for FM at the moment. It's a 5-on-2 situation. If they just cool it down and play smart here, they should be able to win the round.
Let the CTs make the mistake now. There we go. Round lockdown. Chris J left with an M4. Just so we can, that gives us a chance to analyze that. Obviously, I don't think Chris J. He's good, but he's not that good. So 5-1. So we saw an aggressive strategy from Mousesports. I think they're trying to set the tone for the game that they're going to be doing different strats of us every round. They sent two down that A ramp, and Reason cleared up and kind of just won his team the round there. Two great headshots from him, good positioning. And that's going to be interesting for Mousesports. Maybe they need to just kind of play a more traditional game of Team Mirage.
Maybe. What I really like is just a really small sign, a tiny indication of this FM's team that we don't know that much about. You know, we're still learning a little bit about them as we play here. But the fact that they managed to get the 3 opening kills and then still played it slow, they slowed it down, it's a really healthy sign. I love seeing that.
Well, we can see Shiki picks up that AWP from Alu there. See how they're going to implement that into their game. Who's going to be picking that up? As we mentioned before, FM Esports don't really have an AWP to speak of. I know some of them can be quite handy with it. But I had to say, who's going to be jumped onto? They opted to chuck it away. Maybe they said, well, none of us are actually worth using it. Let's get rid of it.
And on the other team,
here we go. This is what we were expecting. Alu and Chris J.
The wombo combo. I mean, Chris is a real monster. Alu, I would say, I think is one of the top orbers in the European team. Yeah. If you are that, you're one of the top orbers in the world. That's been generally how it goes. So definitely a very, very scary combo here, even on Mirage. And I'm wondering, one of them is actually over by the B bomb sign. I'm a big fan of holding the B hallways with that AWP. We'll see if it works out for them.
Well, it's actually, Spuds has actually won AWP. I dropped out and spawned and overbought that gun somehow. But opening frag there from Ligia onto JKM. That's going to set the tone. And this is what we're talking about, slowing down the set strategies.
Yeah, they're here, waiting right here in the middle of Tabson. If he peeks around this corner, two people are waiting. So this is actually looking pretty good, and they must know exactly where he is. I think both Zed and Shiki they have a really good opening into this map. And there's going to be Alu picking down Spuds. Now they've been discovered in this middle area. Alu going to get another kill. Tabson coming around the corner for a quick shot, and Zed will finally take him down. But he is alone looking for the headshot on somebody. He's not going to work out. That was actually a little bit down to timing. I think it's really great. The fact that FM got themselves into that position could have worked out really well.
I just think that that opening frag we saw JKM take there, it almost seemed like it kind of slowed the FM Esports right down. Kind of like they got themselves in those positions, but they weren't facing at the same time. Didn't look like there was any sort of coordination. It seemed like once they lose that first frag, there's a little bit of confusion. And now we're up against Chris J and Alu of Orb. I think it's going to be so difficult to get back in this game. We saw Spuds take the Orb actually last round, and I don't think he's going to be able to cause any trouble against these kind of guys. And you see, like, Alu's looking crisp right now. A nice, good shot from him. And it looks like the T's are going to be just trying to get the bomb down any way they can. But Zed opting towards B with that Deagle. I don't really think they're going to be much happen this round.
I think at this point, Alu has 12 kills, and I think he's looking to take a 13th here in the middle. Going to pick up the one with the AWP. And, well, they're sort of waiting for him here, but he's got backup from Tabson as well. And FM not really going anywhere with this round.
Absolutely not. I think the next round's going to be very important. We can see Mousesports building up a little bit of momentum. It's going to be 6-2 after this round. FM Esports definitely. We mentioned before that the T is the preferred side traditionally people pick online and stuff like that and other events. So we want to see them kind of start racking some rounds together. Like start having this. The more they do this, win one round, lose one, it becomes even more like deadly for them because that's your economy gets absolutely screwed. You need to be stringing rounds together and not getting that $1,400 after losing a round. So this is a big one. It'll be interesting to see what kind of buy they have, what kind of money. Oh, it's not looking great. I don't think we'll see any orbs come out unless Zed is feeling particularly brave. No, he's not. So we can see a kind of a force buy here. We can see not a full arsenal of grenades and a couple of one Galil there as well. So I think we'll be seeing one of these set A tactics perhaps coming into play. It looks like the smokes are coming flying in already, so they know what they're doing. The strategy's been called. And it'll be interesting to see how the CT react to this. A more aggressive tactic coming from the node. How will the fm-esports handle this?
It's really good smoke coming out. That's a nice one. But Legia is pushing up the middle. Really aggressive play coming out from the Mousesports team. See if FM can adjust to it this time. They do take the kill, but they also lose Spuds. And a second kill coming in from Shiki. Very nicely done. Now they have to deal with Alu and the AWP range. And this is where things get really tricky because Alu is on fire. That grenade is going to end one. It could have been a double Shiki down to 3 HP. And it's a 3-on-3 situation here. They have a lot of time to play with, though.
Absolutely. I don't think the CTs need to do these aggressive tactics. So, like, it seems like they're losing the frags early on. They need to play more traditional, but we can see FM opting to go into B now. Looks like the bomb will actually go down. Chris J's in the defending of the AWP. Oh, my God, there it is. He's going to be causing absolute havoc there. And we've got Reason picking up the slack a little bit, and they do left in a 1-on-2 situation.
This is really tricky for him, looking for the first kill. He has still got 45 seconds, and that's the big thing. I almost wish he would just rotate over to the A bomb side at this point, but he can't really know where the rest are coming from, and obviously he's being backstabbed, which kind of puts a timer on it here. Reason now thinking the same thing, just looking to see if anyone's there, but Nuki's going to go down, and that was almost an unwinnable situation for him, I think.
Yeah, but I think he's getting pinched so hard there. Not really much he can do. I think we'll have to see another E-Gate from fm-esports. They really are in a horrible situation right now. They have not got enough money to get any sort of bar on the board.
I mean, 15-1-2 right now for Alu is a ridiculous score at the beginning of this first half. Yeah, he really is.
The opening of a tournament, you think most people would be quite rusty. Not Alu. He's going out all guns blazing, and he's firing on all cylinders right now, and he's seems to be not missing many shots, and FM Esports don't really have much to reply in terms of the top. I think we'll see another couple of kills here. He's been locked out. No, as I say that, another smoke shot from Alu there. Great stuff from him. Really kind of waking up here this early start of the tournament.
Yeah, the bomb is down as well, and this is going to be an easy round cleaned up for Mousesports here. Said is going to be the last man going down. That is a quick triple for Chris J, putting us straight into the 11th round where we have an 8-2 scoreline currently. Mousesports have a really, really good start to Mirage, and it's it's proving difficult. Now they pick up the AWP, so FM are trying to adjust to at least.
Yeah, so hopefully let's stay on the AWP if we can of FM Esports. Let's see where they're opting to kind of take this. Let's see what areas they think are the weaknesses here and where they think they can find a frag. I think they're going to struggle in middle. I just wouldn't recommend trying to face Alu now. I think they'd be better off kind of locking out some of the CTs and flushing them out and forcing them to face with smoke grenades and Molotovs perhaps. But it looks like the CTs are playing a much more passive round this time. No one's actually going to be giving them any sort of leeway in the middle. They've kind of just got this mid area and kind of not going to be able to do a lot with it right now. They've been locked out with smokes.
FM are really quick to get in here. I mean, normally we don't see a terrorist team being able to take control of the ladder room or the connector this quick, but they're just allowing it here, Mousesports. So we'll see if they can actually use these positions for something. That's an interesting pop flash coming in from Tav.
Good work.
Just pop flashing himself in.
So this is how they're going to use the orb. They've got themselves in position where their potential CTs will be waiting for them. We can see Legia there waiting. Oh, there it is. Chris J, big frag, big scalp to take so early in the round.
Yeah, Legia right around the pillar. It's going to go down as well. Shiki picks that one up. Really nice job here. Now, they don't even have to face Tamsin, and they smartly don't. They just smoke him off, put down the bomb, and let him wait. Sed's going to take down Nuki, and we're looking at Tamsin and Alu just running away. They can't really retake this bomb site any longer. So this is a really cool round coming out from FM. I'm loving it.
Yeah, so, well, we can see Mousesports kind of taking a different methodology almost every round. So one round they're aggressive, and one round they kind of play a standard round. Then we saw a very passive, like, they kind of let the T's have middle completely. I think that's to kind of almost lure them into that kind of false sense of security. But I think with the AWP in hand and Spuds making that opening frag there onto Chris J, that was the perfect thing they could have done there. They managed to work out, they were given some room there to move. So, great work from Spuds. Didn't actually drop a frag that round. So, hopefully this is a sign of things to come and they can get themselves back into this. They really do want that 8-7. I think they're going to struggle a lot against this Mousesports team on T. So, they want to get the momentum in their favour now and kind of get their economy back on track. We can see they could, after losing their round, they can afford another gun round after this, but they really just want to get now some momentum in the bank and kind of... Oh, we can see that double AWP setup coming back again for Mousesports.
They saved one of the AWPs on Mousesports, and they can just easily rebuy another one. And they, even losing this round, Mousesports will still be able to buy up. So they are looking pretty good still. We'll see this round. FM switching it up again. Not nearly as aggressive as last round. Trying to see if they can get an opening pick. And Alu's doing the same thing in the middle, going to get flashed. And I think they must have spotted him. He's going to re-peek the middle and take down Spuds.
The AWP are dead.
That's what you said earlier. It was dangerous in that middle.
Yeah, but I just think like it'd be silly to try and challenge him. I think they're better off doing what they did before, kind of going to bomb sites and waiting for a CT to face. Just kind of just flush out Alu, kind of take him out of the game. Like don't try and face him in a 1-on-1. I don't think they've got the talent to take him on.
He almost shot Shiki down. He's on 14 HP, so things are looking really good. And that a really sick boost.
Yeah,
that is actually something I haven't seen before. People just usually peek at the side of the box instead. So that's a very nifty trick coming out from Mousesports.
Here we go. We can see a B execution coming from fm-esports here. I think they've detected there might be only two CTs there, and I think they're going to have to be very quick here if they're going to have any chance of getting in the bomb site. They're going to be two CTs waiting there for them, and like the calls will be coming straight away. There's not enough time here for a fake. They're going to have to commit. So here we go. The execution onto B bomb site.
That's a great smoke as well. Vok, Chris is going to take down one. And oh, looking for a second one.
Sloppy not smoking that window.
Legia with the kill. Chris will pick up the double, and that's going to be the end of the round. So it goes straight from one extreme to the other. Last time it was FM winning a round without losing anyone. Now it's Mousesports' turn.
Yeah, well, like I just said there, I think that the fact they've got set smoke to the B bomb site and they're not smoking out that window, like, you can't take B without kind of closing that window off. Like, you've just got such a disadvantage, especially with an AWPer set up there. You're going to lose at least two kills. Exactly what happened there. Perhaps, kind of like we said before, this team kind of very set in their ways of their strategies, and if it doesn't go their way, they lose that opening frag. They kind of lost a little bit, but we can see another full buy here. Oh god, again, the same pick seems to be happening every round, but Shiki replies there.
It's a really good reply, but I mean, Alu is so quick, and there the boost comes in again. Actually, that won't spot anyone. He's going to jump all the way up on the box here, looking for the kill. He misses it though, and right in front of him, there is someone in for Jane. There's Shiki once again moving in towards the ladder room now. They're going to smoke off towards the window room, just making sure they can get in here, seeing if they can pick up the opening FM. It's about time, but Tabson will take down one. Nuki with the kill. Jakim has to return this one, otherwise there's going to be no chance at all. But with the Galil, and they know where he is in a one-on-four, it's really not looking likely any longer.
No, definitely not. Jakim, Galil in hand, half HP. I really don't see him doing much here, and there it is. That potentially could shut the terrorist onto an eco there. That we saw, like, that force bar. We had Jakim with the... Oh god, yeah, it's all gone wrong. This is really not looking good for FM Esports. So there's another round here, potentially. They can't even afford to get the CZs out, really. To be honest, they're going to have to throw away a round here. So 11-3 potentially for Mousesports. And this might be all she wrote. Like, they should be having more rounds as a terrorist.
Five rounds seems like the absolute minimum you can afford.
Absolutely.
If you stay on three, it's definitely not looking good. We'll see. There's still a pistol round of the second half, of course, but at this point it is looking really tricky for them. And obviously with just pistols here, Tabson just cleaning up, already getting the double, triple, looking to see if he can pick up an ace here with the eco round. Actually, Alu's going to steal that one, so very bad manner coming in here from the Mousesports team members.
Well, here we go then, the last round of the half. Although I'd like to say it's been a good half, it's been very one-sided affair. I think we've seen some moments of greatness from FM. Like, yeah. I wouldn't say they've played awfully, but the rounds they have won have been great. They haven't even lost a frag, and they've kind of done the right rounds. But it just seems like Mousesports are kind of surprised them a little bit too much, and their defense with that AWP and that opening pick has been too strong.
You know, you kind of want to see how this game would have played out if Anu hadn't got those initial smoke shots off in the pistol round. I mean, if
Set
FM could have won that pistol round, it could have been a different game. Not that they would have maybe won the whole game based off of that, but it seems like they would have been able to put a little bit more pressure on.
Yeah, I agree. Well, here we go then. We can see Alu with the AWP. He should be... Oh, God, he's so on form right now. He misses his shot, but FM Esports is going to commit it now to this A-bomb site.
Yeah, they have three people here. Mousesports have a great setup. Alu's going to pick up one more. Goes for the second one. Not going to be able to get it. Spuds will take the return, but it's a 2-on-4 right now. And this is, as you said, the final round of the half here. Zed in the middle, creeping around, looking for the kill. Going to take down Legier, and Spuds will pick up hit Nuki. Two great headshots coming in, but it still leaves Zed alone. He has more than a minute left, but he hasn't got the bomb. And I think Chris knows he's coming. He's going to pick the kill off, and yeah, it's going to be a 12-3 first half in favor of Mousesports.
Yeah, I think I was rooting for my boys. I've got the home crowd here. You can hear them going crazy. but yeah, it's not going to be enough, I'm afraid. Like, especially on the T side, you want to be racking up at least eight rounds, I think. You want to be winning the half as T. So we can see Mouse have got no pressure here. I think they can afford to be a little bit audacious with their pistol strap. They can just Glock armor up and kind of just head anywhere they want, but we can actually see the smoke grenades coming up here. So something a bit more clinical, perhaps, coming up from Mousesports. I think they just want to close this out as soon as possible. They don't want to make sure that FM Esports have any opportunity to get back into this.
Yeah, and they are setting up for the classic smokes here.
There we
actually
go, yeah. Very similar
FM
tactic.
Don't have a really great setup. They have one guy holding here, and another one coming in from the window room, but Reason is going to be in this corner just waiting. And good grenades coming out, actually. Legia down to 14 HP. That's very nice. Flashbang goes in. Shiki's going to pick up a kill on Nuki, but instantly returned on Reason. And Mousesports are going to be able to put the bomb down here. This is going to be a really tough retake. And I love the fact that he has a deagle in a pistol round. That's uncommon.
I haven't seen that since the Source days. I didn't think that was a thing, getting the deagle.
No, definitely isn't. It's a 2-on-4 right now, and a must-win round for FM. Zed is going to be alone, and they're even looking to knife him here. Mousesports really bringing their game right now.
Zed seems to be the player left in this 1-on-3 situation. I think he has been the standout player for FM Esports, but two or three frags for one person each round is not going to be enough. And that's going to tip the favours ever more in favour of Mousesports there, and they're going to have the galils. And will FM opt for the head armour here, do you think, or are they just going to do a traditional kind of CZ round?
I was going to say I wish they would have, but obviously they've chosen not to. So, I think at this point you might as well just go all in and hope for the power of the CZ.
It's all gone horribly wrong now. You might as well see if the Counter-Strike gods have anything left for you. But we can see that the three CZs in the hands of FM. They're not doing anything too special here. It looks like a kind of standard CD setup. No pushes or stacks of anything to speak of here. I would have preferred it if they actually kind of pushed up middle or something like that and kind of got the opening frag.
So a bit of a rough start anyway for the first British team here in the tournament. But yep. At the same time, I mean, I guess this also showcases why Gfinity has thought it's pretty important to maybe try and boost the scene a little bit. Because, some of the British teams are lacking a little bit behind the rest of Europe. And
well, this is the thing. The main problem is lineup changes. And the thing we see every week on HLTV, like these kind of lineups forming. We saw them last week. FM Esports have announced this team for Gfinity. And I think they were Rasta before that.
Yeah.
And I think that's the problem. We see so many. There's no stable teams whatsoever. And I think we're not really missing out on any of the action here. So it's worth just saying kind of easy cleanup for Mousesports here. We're going to be left in a 1-4 situation for reason. But yeah, these events are good. It kind of showcases some of the talent we have. Yeah. Not necessarily the team, but we can see some of the players and how they're kind of level out. And we've seen Zed kind of have some big shots here and big performances. But
well, they've been hitting the shots on FM side. That isn't the problem. But I mean, they're up against Alu for one thing, who has a ridiculous 23-4 scoreline.
Well, that's what those kind of players, they love that kind of momentum. They can get themselves in the zone and kind of feel like they're almost godlike. They died four times like in 18 rounds. Like he's loving it right now. I think this is the perfect warm up game for him. Kind of set himself up. He's found his footing, and now he's going to be ready for the bigger teams. And looks like FM are playing for the draw here. They haven't really they've opted for another eco. I think they've kind of maybe almost admitted defeat here. I think they know what's happening, and I think everyone else does. But in the sake of keeping this exciting, we're gonna keep the narrative going that the big comeback maybe on the cards.
I'd like to see what they can do once they get rifles, and I think we're gonna see at least one rifle round from FM. So we'll see if there's gonna be a little bit better on the CT side here. Obviously, Mousesports just picking the A-bomb site once again. The same smokes we've seen a couple of times. And actually, Sheiky's managed to get down in that position, but it's not good enough. He's going to get picked off by Legia.
So not a lot to do here from Jacob and Reason. I think they'll be looking for a frag maybe to kind of save an AK and maybe use it in their CT campaign. They've got a massive mountain to climb here, but this is LAN. Anything can happen. If they can find a... If they can set up, park the bus on the A-bomb site and hopefully string some rounds together, who knows? Stranger things have happened. We can see CT teams lock it out if they can find their footing, as it were. But looks like, Reason actually does pick up an AK there, so maybe they'll be able to use that and prove them.
They're hunting him. The problem is the bomb is on the one side exploding and they're coming in all from the other side, so I actually think Reason's going to have a really hard time doing this. He's actually going to be the one kill there on Chris, and saving this AK would be big, but Legia is right around the corner. He's not going to be able to do it last second.
Well, here we go then. It'll be interesting to see how the CTs approach this round. I think they're definitely going to need an AWP, and they're going to be wanting to get those early picks. We see Spuds there. He seems to be the designated for FM Esports. He's going to be, I assume, going to the mid window or maybe connector, trying to look what Alu was doing, maybe he can recreate some of that magic. We saw Alu getting a frag pretty much every single round. It was the same pick, maybe a little bit silly from FM Esports to keep facing that angle, but can he perform the same tricks? Here we go. He's going for the same angle. No one's going to face him, though. He's going to be locked out pretty early. It looks like an A execute coming from the terrorist mouse.
That's bad news, but that AWP means very likely, unless he's been very, very good at positioning himself, he's probably going to end up on the wrong side of the smoke.
Yeah.
And then, you know, unless you're Alu, shooting through then and actually hitting anything is a little bit tricky.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's like, this is what they want to do, their standard round mouse scores, and it's going to see how this feeling out the CTs, as it were.
Yeah, really great flashbang. Reason really caught out, just couldn't see a thing. Now they're already rotating in, and the bomb is definitely going to go down here. The question is if Mousesports can hold it. Once the smoke disappears, there's going to be a couple of seconds where FM can try and do it, but it's definitely not going to be easy, and if they waste too much time, it's not going to be working out. There it is, Sheiky and Jacob picking up a kill each, and now they need to go quick here. That bomb already far ticked. Jacob going to take down one more. It's going to be a 3-on-3 right now.
Here we go. There's a glimmer of hope as I say that. There we go. That is all she wrote. Zed is the final man to go down, and unfortunately for the UK home side, that is going to be 16-3 in favour of Mousesports. Interesting opening game. It kind of sets the tone for the UK sides, perhaps.
It does, and also a little bit of a showcase, I think, of how good Mousesports maybe could be on land, because that's the criticism that was leveled against them earlier, is that, online, they look pretty good land, maybe a little bit of a different
They look solid. They didn't look like any issues whatsoever there. I think it's it wasn't obviously the most competitive game. It was a very one-sided affair, but from what I saw, they were hitting those shots, they seemed drilled, and I think they'll be very happy with that performance. That was a great opening for them.
Yeah, but I think you're right. I mean, I guess it is a bit of an interesting insight into where the UK scene might be at, but also where it could go. And I think one of the things that we're missing, because actually a lot of these players, and a lot of the players that is on the other UK team on Infused, that's also here, they mainly come from Source or from 1.6.
Definitely.
And that's where we know them from. But actually something that people forget about is the fact that there's also a whole different level or a whole different wave of people coming in, which is all the people that have never played any of the other Counter-Strike games that are just global offensive players.
Well, I think in other scenes, we see so much of that. We see in the Swedish scene, there's such a huge pool of players and stuff like that, and people coming up and people who, like you said, never even played. We have COD players and all this sort of stuff coming through. And CSGO in the UK especially, it's just old Source players that are kind of holding on to their glory from the CSS days. They haven't been able to reproduce that as of yet in CSGO, but I keep saying this, the talent is there, and it is going to happen. I think it's going to be about a year from now. I don't think we'll see anything until about then, but hopefully, watch this space. This time next year, G4, hopefully, we'll see a UK team actually going against it. But as we say that, the next game coming up, we've got Infused taking on London Conspiracy. It could be interesting. Hopefully, a closer game. We know Infused have been a team slightly longer than FM, so who knows?
I hope so. I think also they have their maybe. I would say their talent pool is a little bit bigger. I hope so. I'm expecting that's going to be a slightly more interesting game. But of course, it's going to be down to it. We'll see. We're going to go back to the caster's desk, to the analyst desk, to see if we can get some wise words on that. So, Scoots, if you're ready, then take it over.
All right. Thank you, Anders and Henry G. Yeah. Well, I think we all kind of thought it would at least be a little.